School of Architecture and Planning at the University of the Advanced Structure in South Africa and a research fellow at the Institute of Social and Economic Research. I'm just going to get started right away. I start from the position that colonial planning is warfare by other means. The reorganization of space is also the reorganization of time, and we live and think in colonial space-time. For me, thinking otherwise about space and thinking about space, place and rhythm is a refusal of colonial space-time and an insistence of other spaces and ways of being otherwise. South African filmmaker and scholar Ndugam Tambo argues that artistic research may stimulate the development of techniques of reading and writing that are characterized by artistic practices of openings and enclosures and encounters between diverse fields of knowledge and epistemes. This notion of what he calls an agglutinative mode of inquiry provides a way of organizing information that is agrammatical and that has the capacity to oscillate rapidly between several modalities. This formal fluidity framed my curatorial project titled African Mobilities. This is not a refugee camp exhibition. Was an approach that, for example, sought to order research questions regarding art and design in conditions of instability and flux. I will slow down. Apartheid spatial planning in South Africa has a long prehistory that began with settler colonialism, wholesale disposition of the indigenous population through the 1913 Native Land Act and the introduction of segregationist urban policies in the late 19th century under British colonial rule. First in KwaZulu-Natal and later across the territory that came to be known as the Union of South Africa in 1910. In the 1970s, Nadine Swanson argued that sanitation has long served as a trope of colonial urban administration. Bubonic plague in the port town of Port Elizabeth in the early 20th century provided the pretext for displacing the urban population from the colonial town to the outskirts of the city. Elsewhere, South African scholar Sue Parnell explains how women were seen as harbingers of social disorder in the slum yards of Johannesburg in the 1920s and the 1930s, as African migration into urban centers increased alongside the expansion of mineral extraction across Southern Africa. Needless to say, the hysteria surrounding the presence of unattached African women in cities was attached to colonial imaginaries of pathologized African bodies as inherently grotesque, lewd, hypersexual, and diseased. The regulation of black mobility, both within the framework of male coercive labor migration on white-owned mines and farms, was subtended by colonial desires to regulate and reconfigure black family structure and black sexuality through the large-scale black land disposition and the creation of native reserves, racial residential zoning and forced removals, segregation, using infrastructure as a socio-technical mechanism of control and housing as a means to regulate and contain, constrain black urban settlement. So the image that you see up on the screen is from an art installation curated by Leslie Perkins in 2010, featuring the artwork of South African artist Mary Sibande. And the artist series is titled Long Live the Queen. And essentially it was a 13 building project where they enlarged Mary Sibande's artwork and wrapped it around buildings in the inner city of downtown Johannesburg that were either derelict or abandoned or had been occupied by people who were largely seen as undesirable by the municipal administration of Johannesburg. In many ways, the spatial imagination for downtown Johannesburg was framed through an apartheid spatial planning imaginary that was also and merely a modernization of a racial spatial formation that had been unfolding unevenly over a period of three centuries. So even in post-apartheid South Africa, the imagination of the city as inherently white is a persistent trope that shapes the imagination of what the future of the city should be. So tracking the artwork of Mary Sibande through the city established a conversation between me, the curator, and the artist, and the city about what the histories and the futures of the city might possibly be. The thing that is most profound for me about Mary Sibande's work, are the complex spatialities embedded in the artistic representation, where the blue gown is a Victorian gown that references a very particular era of extraction and British colonialism. The blackening of the skin, for me, references a kind of minstrelsy, but also the idea of the black domestic worker as a shadow figure within the whole, a central figure of white settler bourgeois domesticity. I am concerned, more specifically, with questions of blackness as being ungeographic. I'm concerned with African urbanism and artistic spatial imaginaries as an epistemological category that can advance the project of knowledge production in architecture and urbanism. For me, this involves a deterritorialized approach to knowledge production that seeks to escape the spell of the status quo through sublime landscapes, their incommensurability, and the willingness of its subjects to be free. As such, our urban landscapes, as argued by Catherine McKittrick, are neither complete nor fully intelligible. Instead, black landscapes are permeable and material indications of the uncertainty of place. In her seminal text, Demonic Grounds, Catherine McKittrick argues that black geographies are located within and outside the boundaries of traditional spaces through black social particularities and knowledges that locate and speak back to the geographies of modernity, transatlantic slavery, and colonialism. These rhizomatic black geographies demonstrate both the limitations and possibilities of traditional spatial arrangements through the ways the black subject is produced by and is producing geographic knowledge, which in turn give rise to black imaginations and mappings as evidence of a struggle over social space. So one of the research questions that I arrived at after following Mary Sabanda's artwork through the inner city of Johannesburg is where else one might find representations of African women in contemporary African urbanism. And one of the sites where black women are not only represented but are also producing space is in the practice of hair braiding. So hair braiding is a practice that occurs along one of the major transportation arteries in downtown Johannesburg, where up to 100 women are advertising hair services in the downtown of the city. But these advertising practices are also a remapping of the city, where the women lead you into the vertical, abandoned spaces of downtown Johannesburg that produce their own fractal, intimate geographies that are transnational, spaces of intimacy, spaces of sexuality, spaces of celebration, and also spaces of care and vulnerability. But for the remainder of this presentation, what I really want to explore is how African urban imaginaries might be informed by contemporary urban transformations in African cities through a reading of Dreamscapes, a short speculative animation film based in Lagos and created by Brooklyn-based artist Olele Kanjefis and Lagosia Walelawal for the African Mobilities Exhibition as part of the Imagine City submission. Part of the interest of these works that were produced through African mobilities was an interest in how African and black artists spatialize blackness in ways that do not repeat two dominant tropes attached to African urban environments. First, that African societies are simple, ahistorical, and trapped in panoptic time. And secondly, the victor is a slum of social death, a time space that tracks the territorialization of black life as the locus of black death and anti-black violence alone. Instead, I'm interested in how blackness functions as a site of radical imagination and new modes of representation, in short, a kind of madness. So the artwork that you see on the screen was produced by Dana Wabira, Nolan Oswald Dennis, and Tenkosi Goniwe as part of a curatorial project that I had undertaken over a two-year period. And in its first iteration that was staged at the Architecture Museum in Munich, a project that was funded by Kulturstiftung des Bundes, Nolan sent a text message to explain to me what the diagram is. The original dimensions of this diagram are about 14 meters in length and 5 meters in height. So I want to quote the WhatsApp message that I received via Dana from Nolan about this diagram. And I want to quote him because I think that only he can express this reimagination of black space beyond and against traditional tropes of the colonial archive. And I quote, "The diagram works with an understanding of space measured not by distance, but by the rhythms provoked at the intersection of what Tengosi Koniwe describes as roaming lives and turbulent flows. The legend itself is a cipher which must be interpreted. The index on the far right codifies aspects of this rhythm through registering three notions of time at play in this diagram. Number one, song time, which is the time marked by the bar or measure corresponding to a specific number of beats, the compound unit of time in musical notation. This index catalogs the line types at play in the diagram as looping vectors of sound. Each line corresponds to conceptual position listed beneath it. Two, colonial time, which is marked by a linear relationship between what is dominated and yet to be dominated, past and future. This list of dates chronicles significant dates in the colonial and post-colonial history of Southern African rail network. Three, decolonial time, which is marked by discontinuities, reversals, inertias, and swings that overlay one another and interpenetrate one another and envelop one another, an entanglement after bending. This index reflects the structure of time when the railway is understood as a sonic vector determined by African roaming lives. These dates are the release dates or not of the songs that punctuate the diagram." So this is the outcome of a research project that African Mobilities helped to support. That was a collaboration between artists based in South Africa and Zimbabwe that was reimagining the territory of, Southern African space beyond the sort of delineations of the Berlin conflicts. And by looking at the railway line and the histories of extraction, and tracing the railway line that links South Africa to Mozambique, to the Congo, to Zambia and Zimbabwe, they basically reconceptualize the entire territory of Southern Africa, thinking about temporalities that are complex, but also about sound as the smallest possible unit that you can use to measure human experience. So here you have a group of artists who are grappling with questions of language in ways that architectural practitioners haven't been able to deviate. And this is part of the intellectual and cultural project that I'm interested in. How do we actually develop vocabularies that help us to think beyond colonial tropes and colonial vocabularies and to imagine space differently and produce different modes of representation? The second example that I want to discuss is a set of drawings that were produced by a very young architecture graduate called Aisha Balde from Guinea. And it's situated on a site 22 and a half kilometers off the coast of Cape Verde. So this Ghanaian architect, Aisha Balde, explored the interplay between physical and imagined spaces in ways that allow us to rethink our understanding of state, boundary, and space. Through drawings, Aisha probed fluid notions of territory, exploring the in-between spaces that contradict what she considers to be its two conventional underpinnings of site and state. Rather than colonizing this territory through surveys and inventory, Balde marks an otherwise vast and seemingly empty surface with a series of notations and inscriptions and numbers that uncover hidden spatial relationships through a range of cartographic procedures of selection, schematization, and synthesis, which make the map, the territory, and the site already a project in the making. This is also a project that, as part of the African Mobilities exploration of how we can think through questions of mobility and African circulation beyond the trope of the black body suffering in the middle of the Mediterranean, was a collaboration with Chimurenga where we produced a library on circulations in which we began to map out different ways in which African circulations and mobility could be thought and theorized beyond the language of crisis, and also as a kind of counter-cartography to these kinds of colonial tropes that are still being circulated in the present. So one of the modalities or methods that I used in terms of working through the question of African urban imaginaries was through an understanding that each space had its own very specific set of histories and particularities. And so part of the project was to establish a series of platforms across the African continent that would described as exchanges. In total, there were about 7 exchanges with participants from 14 different African countries that included Uganda, Zimbabwe, South Africa, Cape Verde, Angola, Nigeria, Guinea, Senegal, Cote d'Ivoire, but also the United States and contributors from New York. And the idea was really to have a series of encounters and collaborations that were hosted by these exchanges where the artists would meet in the host city and explore a set of themes that would then be shown in the exhibition. So the exhibition was not an end in itself, but rather a means through which to think about how spatial practitioners, architects, and researchers could actually explore questions of African spatiality beyond what beyond the limitations of what professional architectural training has to offer. So this was really an invitation to people who are outside of traditional institutional frameworks like architecture schools or art schools to be in conversation and to produce knowledge. And another dimension of the exchanges was to create new publics for conversations about architecture and design across the African continent. In my previous life, I was a curator for a space called Studio X Johannesburg that was part of a global network of experimental studios run by Columbia University. And it was a wonderful experience in terms of thinking about how to curate conversations in the city about art. But a lot of the critique of the Studio X model was really that it was geared towards empowering American students who have the privilege of international travel, whereas African design students don't have the luxury of international travel. So the platforms are really a vehicle to produce or to create a mobility of ideas within the African continent, as opposed to re-inscribing the kind of knowledge asymmetries that exist between institutions on the African continent and institutions in Europe and also in North America. So this is one of the exchanges that that we organized, and this was a collaboration with the Julieta Art Station run by Dana Wabira, and we had Nolan Oswald Dennis on the left, and members from participants from the Zimbabwe National Gallery on the far right, as well as Milika J. Wadim in the center. So this was a public event that was open to the public where they basically got to explore some of the initial ideas that then gave rise to the output for the African Abilities exhibition. But I want to return to the question of futures and also by way of closing, because I feel like I've been talking forever. The question of African futures is an important site of exploration, precisely because Africans have discursively been understood as those who have no future. More specifically, the study of African architecture and African cities has been informed by a number of Enlightenment imaginaries, developmentalism, humanitarianism, that limit the scope of what might constitute an imaginable future or futures. In contrast to this discourse, Oleleka and Jafis's Shanti megastructure projects alternative heterotopic futures for Lagos in the face of large-scale real estate redevelopment, displacement, infrastructure, and developmental precarity of the lagoon, which he explored in an American Institute of Architects design competition for a skyscraper. Jafis's visual assemblages overlay various technological ecologies associated with urban modernity, infrastructures alongside the technologies of fishing rafts and suspended wooden homes to produce a future imaginary of Lagos that forces a more direct confrontation with two seemingly disparate yet intimately intertwined urban milieu. In fact, the shanty, as he calls it, becomes the ordering principle through which technology is both articulated, that subverts conventional tropes that link technological advancements with Western modernity. Shanty megastructure constitutes an inversion of the visual grammars of a mythical Western urban modernity, understood as infrastructure and technological innovation, in order to produce new symbolic orders imbued with both sensorial and political experiences that heighten the visibility of the most marginalized urban populations of Lagos. As argued by Charles Davis III, Jafis synthesizes the megastructural scale and technological themes of post-war architectural utopianism with the nuanced interpretations of the everyday. This futurist vision stakes out black spaces in the future while making distinctive statements about modernization and oppression as co-equal, the past and the present. In a further iteration of the megastructure project, Jafis and Lagosian writer Wale Nawal met in real time in Lagos And what we produced was a graphic novella, which is shown on the screen right now, an animated film that I'm about to show, and four 360 virtual reality sets. So a futurist project like Madness City works on the exposure and reframing of futurisms that act to forecast and fix African dystopia. They created an anticipatory narrative and designs that reassembles the predatory futures forecast over the next 100 years as not only a future characterized by unmitigated despair, but also characterized by the promise for intervention within the dimension of the anticipatory and the future conditional in the figure of Akura Kuda. In the film Dreamscapes that I'm about to show, very short film, they map out the possibilities available for subjects whose everyday lives in the future Lagos appear to be saturated with the logics of a carceral, predatory, neoliberal capitalist development and futurist technologies that colonize their conscious and subconscious lives. However, one of the recurring themes of these moments that they produced for the exhibition is the figure of the outsider. This outsider position is not merely the function of exclusion, but also a central trope in understanding those whose agency locates them outside the framework of power. The outsider is as a figure of dynamism and instability rooted in two historical figurations, the revolutionary slave of C.R.R. James in the Black Jacobins on the Haitian Revolution, and women, and within that structure, the prostitute. So, in terms of showing the different modalities that we explored, Dreamscapes is a moment, one of three moments that Wale Lowell and Olele Kanjaif has developed in this narrative of Lagos 100 years in the future. And the narrative, which is largely narrated in English and Pidgin, is about a future that is completely sort of technological, but also imagining multiple and diverse and different technological and design futures that don't conform to this kind of really sanitized Enlightenment ideal of what the future holds.
According to the lifetime on his forehead, 7 minutes and 48 seconds left to live.
Through their counter-cartographies of marginalized sites, they render visible an understanding of the terrain of the refugee and the outcast, cast adrift on a surface of complex and dynamic social, political, historical, and environmental processes. For Balde and Madrigal City, site is a mediated state of being that is constituted through an entanglement with the simultaneous multiplicity of things and temporalities. Thank you.
Aranda, the second presenter, Martinez. So the rest of the panel, or whatever this thing is, since Chus and I are presenting together, we have had the chance of working together for several years. We thought that it would be nice to be a little bit in conversation to address the issue of research and what we have done together. So, I am, more than anything, I am an artist, and I also, I have worked on this exhibition, so to see it. But I also co-run a platform called Influx, and we, for the last 10 years or so, we have put out a journal of art and thought and research and whatnot. Now, this has, so I was originally quite enthusiastic about research as an idea. Now I have to confess that I am not. The more time passes, the less I, the less captivated I am, at least as an artist, by the notion of research. Especially because as an artist, I realize I make a really lousy anthropologist of research. My methodology is flawed. If I try to follow like the tenets of anthropologists, I find my work gets really, really boring. And I also feel that I am trying to label my curiosity with names that make it easy to apprehend, and I become really suspicious and really uneasy about that kind of label. So, I mean, the more I think about it, I think that it's quite good if other disciplines resemble art and try to follow that kind of outcome, but I'm not so sure that art should try to resemble the scientific method, at least not in my case. So this is something that I have come to the conclusion also when, after being asked to talk about the artist as a researcher in a number of occasions, and getting more and more irritated about having to define myself and describe myself as and talk about my findings and my kind of as if I was talking about specimens. And this is just, yeah, I kept being more and more alienated from my own work if I had to look at it under that guise. So what I started to look at to understand what was going on with my own practice and my own process, so what I did was look at what my subject matter was, or what my topics, the things that fascinate me are. And yes, something that I do have in common with researchers, official researchers, is that I can stay focused on a particular topic for 10 years at a time. And I can look at it and work on it and address it and scratch at it, poke at it, but stubbornness does not make research. It just means that I'm very stubborn and I don't get bored so easy. But so the things that matter to me the most, I think, are, have been for a long time, ideas of circulation, ideas how does that enter how circulation becomes visible, not just as an enabler between consumption and production, but actually as an agent on itself. That moved into an interest for time and shape-shifting. So particularly that idea of being curious about time and realizing that a lot of what happens when we talk about the future is intimately related to the fact that we run out of space. And because we don't have holes in the map and spaces that we can actually explore, we start to evolve and move into the colonization of time. And into this kind of like forever present, we're trying to decide what's going to be 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 100 years from now. So in resisting that, and in thinking about shape-shifting, I started to close off a lot of this like opening of my work into these like bite-sized chunks that I can deliver as findings. So I guess the best way to explain this a little bit is to talk about the video that I'm going to show you now, which is the second part of a trilogy, the third part of which is being shown in Cosmopolis 2. And it's a work that has, the three films have taken me some 10 years to make, not really, 7 years to make. Dealing with notions of space. The third part is dealing with, this is kind of like a classic telephoto approach where I'm going from dealing with space travel and the larger notion of space to a one-to-one space and ideas of architecture and design to the and kind of curiosity for what interior space and invisible space can be, which is the film that is being shown here. But since the process that I follow to reach this has to do with things from looking at the sexual habits of octopi to comic book billions, bad guys, to reading books from hostile architecture and things like that, I really don't want to to restrict my practice into the very comfortable, click through slides and explain to you how I reach my ideas. That's why I'm showing you a video. That's why I actually also want to talk with Chus, who has been very patient with this mode of working for the last 10 years that we have worked together. So then maybe I show the video now, press the space bar, and here it goes.
High-tech gendered imaginations are produced here. Imaginations that can contemplate the destruction of the planet and the sci-fi escape from its consequences.
Sci-fi bubble here, but even an economic imaginary will requires real human bodies to test the spaces that are being imagined. No, not us. We pass. This is not a matter of us and them. We pass for the city infrastructure. Define binding.
Architecture, artifacts, traffic.
It is different now. We are approaching a new Wild West period for humanity.
our temporality is future-oriented. And progress demands new skills, new language.
The elderly are like hard drives in old dying formats.
Yeah, like floppy disks or magnetic tape.
But isn't that what formats are? Forgetting? Similar to language, old and new English? Change doesn't come from things, but from the way things are done.
That the only force to oppose the development in climate change would be to stop, and to stop would be to return. Research is the way to articulate a return. You need to return to a point which is deeper than the point that you are now, and then you need to abandon the surface in order to go to something else which is deep down there in order to take, to extract. So the logic of research is the logic of extraction. You need to actually combine that kind of dichotomy or dualistic view in between something that appears and something which is behind what it appears, which is deeper than it appears, and may actually possess a deeper meaning, a meaning that is not revealed into the surface. In that oppositional force in between that phenomenal space of the surface and that other space of the meaning, there is a violence, and that violence gets resolved. The violence gets resolved, and then you create a balance. You can actually come to an end point. You can actually show something that you can present as a fact. The fact is the balance. The fact is the knowledge. So we could say, actually, that knowledge is the invitation of administrating those facts, and also trying to administrate the balance that is created after that kind of force of this dualistic way of thinking has created. So knowledge is actually an administrative force that is very important to create a consensus. So the main goal of knowledge is actually to be consensual. Why? Because if knowledge would not be ultimative, be consensual, it is impossible to establish a discipline. And actually to stabilize the discipline in order for it to be repeated, to be perpetuated, to be continued. So I would say that one of the big problems of inviting us, coming from culture, of doing research, is the problem that many of those that have been already there wanted to avoid. So I would actually say that to do artistic research is today morally wrong. Because actually we should not perpetuate what others try to escape. Because they cannot, because their disciplines have been stabilized. They have been already taking a form that they want to decolonize, that they want to also to expand to an equality, not only of the forces that actually are created inside those disciplines, but also go beyond an idea of the social construction and the knowledge construction and the idea of how this social and knowledge construction perpetuate an idea of the colonial, not only through the historical moment of the colonial, but also, you know, what we inherit as a way of articulating the space in the Enlightenment. So, let's say, research is morally wrong also under the point of view of a messianic force. So it still, it invites you to return. So stop drinking with plastic. Then you change your behavior, but actually you may not change your understanding and your feeling towards the force that you are talking about. So you are technifying, you are actually instrumentalizing something that is much complex than that. So, but then if you say stop doing something, it's an invitation to return. Research is an invitation to return. You need to return to a time that is prior to your time, to a space that is prior to your space. If you don't possess that time or your space, it's okay to take it from others. It's okay to actually expand that idea of return through, you know, the colonial spaces that you have been occupying, historically speaking. So first you return in order to project. So you use the force that's going backwards in order to go forward. So why? Because you believe strongly that there is an horizon. There is kind of an aim. That aim and that horizon can be collectively constructed. That collectively constructed horizon is based on the fact that you are all looking in the same direction. Only if we are all consensuating the fact that we are looking in the same direction, then we can recognize what research is. Because otherwise, if you are all looking in different directions, you create a complexity that is impossible to consensuate. Knowledge is consensus. You need to administrate that through a discipline. You need to actually perpetuate that discipline through structures that we very well know. So in order to challenge that, don't do research. You should do something else. And I would say that, polemic as it might sound, the only thing that we can do more than ever is philosophy, because we need to clarify the models at work. Simply speaking, I would say that there is two big models at work that right now are clashing like never before. One is the social constructivist model that is actually like Lego, Duplo, or anything which is modular and things that adds to other things, that goes back and forth in a dialectical way, but still is adding to a plus, and then it would achieve some sort of end result that would kind of sublimate our present and pasts, and then kind of redeem us in a way that we would be satisfied. It would be fulfilling, and yet it would start again. So that's the classical way of understanding dialectics. The other model that was considered for many years very problematic, and still is in the way that is very difficult to talk about it, to express it, to describe it, and to communicate it, because it's still very deep in our way of thinking, but not deep enough in our disciplines, in our consensus. We could call it the expressionist model. One that is actually trying in all corners of our social, talking about, you know, the sentient, the possibility of actually locating intelligence beyond the human, not going forward or backwards in our human history, but thinking about the possibility of life after the disaster. To think about after the disaster, after, you know, if you don't stop acting like that, what is the menace? It's gonna end. If you don't stop actually acting like artists, you should do research, or art is gonna end. The social has no need for these kind of activities that don't have that messianic force and power on it, colonialism. So there is actually something which is there, and it's very present, and it's very active. In order to counteract it, we do need an imagination of expression, the sentient life, and a trust in intelligence that is not based only on transmitting the virtues of the human into everything which is inorganic. So, you know, if you do research, you are doing mining, basically speaking. And if you do something else, you are actually activating forces of immanence that don't allow you for distinctions. That would mean that the traditional ideas of the autonomy of judgment are very difficult to sustain. How is then possible the transmission of ideas and the transmission of something that we learn to name as criticality? Very difficult, but not impossible. So in the last years, I've been asking myself what's to be done. And I think that the only thing to be done is really trust and soak and marinate in many of the works and efforts that many, many, many artists around the world are doing in trying to actually locate that interconnectivity of the sentient life and how this affects intelligence and the construction of the social through a language that distinguishes itself from the traditional languages that we did inherit for the social constructivist model that has been inspiring, for example, cultural studies and, of course, everything that we call, you know, the critical thinking. So it's nothing about rejecting, it's really evolution, I would say. But it's an evolution that is absolutely necessary if we are really aiming towards equality. An equality that is not only affecting the human, but is affecting every form of life and every sense of the practice. So what can we do? Back to the trust of artists, it's many, it's really many people working in that, trying to locate, identify, and describe, and give a form to it, a form that is much less consensual, that is based in completely different parameters. And in doing so, the only thing that we can do, if you work in the fields of art, is actually asking yourself about a total transformation, radical transformation of the curriculum upon which we teach, we talk about, and we transmit, and actually communicate and create a dialogue among ourselves, this on the one hand. And the other hand is to ask ourselves in a really radical way, what would it be if we actually don't criticize or negate the spaces that we historically inherit, like the museums, the web cubes, the galleries, the venues that we know, the collections that we know, the way of ordering that we know, but with some sort of, we suspend it and ask ourselves, could it be the ocean and art space? If your answer to that question is, oh, that's such a beautiful metaphor, you still have a problem with dialectics and you still have a problem with colonialism. If you embrace the possibility of doing the next documenta in a forest, then you have less of a problem when it comes to thinking about this interaction. You may have some technological problems, you may have some social ticketing problems, economic problems, problems with the politicians, not understanding your funding, but definitely is probably an interesting way to do. Why? Because at the core of the tensions that we try to describe again and again, that we try to actually debate, there is a very important thing, which is called violence. And if there would be a consensus in that second model that I call the expressionist one, is the possibility of building life without violence. So I would end it here. So, since we are open a little bit less of a time, we can pose a question or two to Julieta or she to me, and then invite them both to the table and continue the debate and then continue it with you. I think that one thing that you have been saying that for me kind of coincides with what I was trying to say is the question of the end of the distance that it's mentioned in the video, and I would like you to say a couple of words on that.
I mean, well, like one thing about the video is that it's not, it doesn't subscribe, it's not a one-to-one reflection of how I think, it's actually a number of perspectives, and some of them are pretty dark and almost a little bit sinister, however, not that in the case of distance. The, I mean, it's, I find it quite fascinating that with how much we parcel things into geographies when the reality is that we are completely connected. So there is more distance in the sense of, how to say, from one place to the other, from the other, it's not physical distance, but the distance becomes much more intangible, right? Like the distance now is built into a passport. The distance now is built into access to water. I mean, like it's I don't like to explain myself clearly, right? But
you are and you are not.
I mean, it's what, I mean, because, okay, so if you have a, if you are German or if you have a fantastic bank account, you don't, distance does not exist for you.
Yes, I suppose.
So that's the kind of like end of distance that the particular character that you're
talking about. Talking about the virtual space, or you are talking also about the distance that separates us from judgment, so to say. So it's both the metaphorical space and the physical one?
I mean, in that particular place, it's referring to the to access, like distance as access.
And at the beginning of your talk, you were saying that you would kind of wish that others would be doing research like art.
No, it's not exactly a wish. I mean, like I think it makes things more available in an affective sense.
So you mean adding a dimension of affection to the reality?
Not affection, but affect, or a kind of availability, in a way. That's like the word that touches me the most of anthropologists, people like that, which end up representing their findings in ways that are less dry, let's say.
But you are also saying, I think you are not presenting the artistic practice as a model.
No.
Exactly. You were worrying me for a second.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's good.
No, I'm just sort of like, kind of like refusing the idea that if you're engaged with a certain set of topics, then you fall into the avenue of research immediately.
So what you are saying is that actually spending time with something does not equal the traditional way of understanding research, but this is not a minus. There's absolutely no problem in not equaling, not matching that model.
I mean, perhaps, you know, like, and I'm very grateful for research that has been done. I just don't want to classify my work into that way because I do not want to create taxonomies, because I do not want to have that kind of rigor that you require to do proper research. And trying to claim for myself the freedom to make wider connections and to follow crazy rabbits down crazy holes, I find research or the labor of the methodologies a little bit constraining, A, and B, when I follow them, I find that my work becomes bad.
But it could be also read as a polemic in the sense that, for example, I don't believe in that distinction, meaning research as a form, but I don't know if it's rigorous or not, and the artistic practices has another. But so, you know, you are not defending your freedom versus the rigor, but your freedom versus the freedom.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that it's the point that, within art, right, I don't want to necessarily focus on, or I'm not interested in producing art that's focused on the history of certain things, but on the possibility of imagining difference. And perhaps, you know, in my case, in the case of the art that I subscribe to, in order to imagine difference, I need to spend a little bit less time in analyzing the taxonomy, because I don't want to create another taxonomy. Maybe I'm more interested in things a little bit dirtier, a little bit more connected.
That's understood. Now, if we could invite Mpho to come to the table as well. I think you were talking about architecture, but then the examples and the way that you were describing the practice is actually working with artists.
Almost all the artists that I work with have an architectural training.
Uh-huh.
So I find the conversation about this tension between like research and creative practice curious, because what I found is that everyone I worked with had hybrid identities and that they spoke in many different languages. So one A can write fiction, but he's studying history and is interested in political economy and works for some big corporate finance firm. Lick studied architecture, but now largely works in animation and film and different things. And I find that for me, the most interesting people to speak to about contemporary African urban forms are people who actually have multiple identities as opposed to singular ones.
I'm actually not talking about any tension. I'm talking about the necessity of philosophically addressing the model that is inherent into the naming of research. People may do research, but I would never call it like that, or I would advocate for not falling into the trap of that model of thinking, which is based on dialectics. But this is a totally different thing, because what you are saying makes complete sense, and many of us are working with people with, you know, not only multiple identities, but with practices that are very difficult to identify in a single way, so to say, and how necessary this is. But many politicians would call it experimental. But I would never use the word experimental, as I would never try to deploy academy out of innovation. So it's, you know, but this is a different conversation, I suppose.
And I think that it's also situated, right? So I live and work in a context where one has to find and create conditions of possibility for people to do interesting work, and we'll call it by many different names. And I think that for me, the bigger question is more about what are the conditions of possibility, right, for people to produce work.
No, no, I also want definitely more money. It's only that I think that if we continue using this terminology, where kind of is like trying to dance in a certain way, dress as a bride, it's kind of still, it has the connotation of being married, being a woman, the first night about to come. So these kind of things is what I think it's important to avoid in a philosophical way. But of course, the conditions we want to create, definitely, we really want the future of all the spaces, curatorial spaces, institutional spaces, academic spaces, be absolutely populated by the people that we are actually describing in those sessions.
I don't know much about dialectics, but I was quite interested in the idea of undercommons and the place and the uses of the university, particularly in contexts where its traditions, its intellectual genealogies are generally hostile to Black people, African history, African modes of being. So one is always thinking against its structure and finding ways to read its infrastructures and its logics against itself, so that those debates that require a certain kind of purity are things that one has to play with, or one is forced to. So I'm in a university setting that only understands work in particular formats, and it doesn't necessarily create spaces for creative work to happen. So the question is, you know, for me, the logic of like insisting on creative research is more about fighting for a space for creative work within the university rather than imposing a kind of disciplinary grid onto creative practice. But I'm working in a very specific institution.
No, I'm working exactly in the same setting. So by running a university is exactly the type of language that they impose you in order to get the funding. But what I'm saying is that it would be interesting to surpass that imposition and actually philosophically ask ourselves what is the space that we are replicating. But of course, take the money, and on Monday in the session I do say yes to artistic research when they give me the money. But I think that it's part of the conversation not to go so far along the lines, because otherwise I'm constructing a building exactly as I'm told to do. And that's why I see the problem.
One of the things to say here, this is what presentative works, is that, I mean, like, this is something that I face when I have to write a project proposal to get that money that we are talking about, right? And when I'm writing that project proposal, if I frame it within the tenets of what artistic research is, I am obliged to know my proposed outcome. What it is that I want to find, and the reality is that an artist, I don't know. And if I know, why on earth am I making it work? It's already, it already exists and it's already there. Now, this is a question I grapple with as myself, now I am teaching, and it comes to me to think what kind of artists I want to help form. Do I want to create these fantastic grand writers and these people that can claim their work so well that they know it before they have made it? Or do I want to still have this kind of, I want them to get the money, of course, I want to get it myself, but I also want to keep poking holes into that comfort zone and that comes with the territory of inhabiting a space that is so perfectly defined. That's why I am kind of like latching onto the word and the definition and trying to problematize it again, because I think it gets cozy in a way. As much as it enables, it also suppresses things.
I guess I just don't experience academia as a space of comfort.
Of comfort.
Yeah.
Of comfort, yeah.
But there's a specificity here. And I'm thinking about the student protests in South Africa and the calls around decolonizing the institution, the fact that there's a fundamental questioning of what this institution does and who it's for and its modalities. So this idea of, I guess I don't operate from a position of seeing or experiencing institutions as spaces that are safe. In fact, they are profoundly and deeply violent. So thinking about how one can factor in or build creativity into it, or rethink modes of knowledge production is a very important question. Perhaps artistic research is not the modality, but the current form is unworkable.
I think you are very right. The other day we were having a wild discussion because if one of the few rights that I kept in the fine arts in Switzerland is that I may be able to, or I am able to, accept people's surdossiers, so people that did not attend the school. And they wanted to take it away, or they attempted to ask me to take it away in the name of actually not only regulating, but also decorating, because higher education gets better and more pyramidal. You have a basis, and then the best and the best and the best and the best, and then you have again this kind of metaphor of something being at the peak, something being at the basis, talking about horizontal ways of structuring knowledge and producing it, but also picking it all the time, like picking it in, you know, on the top this, top that. And then it's like, I told themselves, I really want to do research, and the research, I want to send it down. I really want to send the research down, deep down, in lower education. And I want to maintain the right of surdossier as my way of researching exactly if we are capable or not to recept, to engage, to talk, and to send something down there, so that the way of feedback that we are establishing with the social and the community would be different than the channels that you have been orienting everyone to go through, so that they reach me at the door because they have the right degree. And it was very fascinating because it took some hours, and at the end they said, well, the idea of sending research down, we never heard of that, and it's just absolutely, you know, from which planet are you coming, but just to keep the right of accepting people's associates. So, but the next step, I think, would be to actually send research down, but not down in the depth, but in the basis, like not into the PhD, but in the praxis, and like kind of spread it flat, like it would be butter.
Yes, I think that the debate we're having about basically disciplining artists, professionalizing it in this academic framework, does need to be expanded in terms of like what kinds of challenges does thinking the academy from that perspective actually open up, right? So, the question of horizontality, thinking about different modes of teaching and learning, thinking about different locations in which teaching and learning happens is really important. So, for me, and it's not so I've had a lot of, I had a lot of failures in the African Mobilities Project because the infrastructure just doesn't allow it. It's incredibly expensive and difficult to move across the African continent, even as an African with an African transport. Our institutions are underfunded, people don't get to move. So one has to think very creatively around how you create conditions, not just getting the money, but how do you actually get conditions of possibility for people who don't have the privilege of mobility. So what does this mean in terms of like thinking creatively around teaching and learning pedagogy?
We were speaking a little bit about that before we got into the boarding table, whatever this is called, and the similarities of mobility between Africa and Latin America, which is where I come from, and the fact that actually, you know, like, I come to meet other Latin Americans, not in the American continent, but in New York or in the North American continent or in Berlin or in, I don't know, Paris or whatever else, but the communication in between countries, of Spanish-speaking countries in Latin America is completely fragmented, and we are really strangers to one another. Now, of course, there is, for the last 10, 15 years, like a big impetus in trying to bridge that distance and figuring out modes of speaking with one another. I think something that also, with this like suspicion about formalizing and this domesticating the exchanges into the rubric of okay, I presented to you as findings, it kind of like takes away some of the some of the affect of the encounters that they produced. So that's again why I speak the way I speak and why I'm like latching on so stubbornly on the things that I'm latching on. Because I still want to find the ways to produce those encounters and to take the trouble of the expense of time and the expense of resources to facilitate an exchange that is not mapped now as de facto, as like the standard exchange, without making it, so how to produce those exchanges without making them mimic and the accepted and normal exchanges, how to carve a path for them. And of course, the practicalities immediately raise their head. It's like, how are you going to fund it? How are you, where are the resources going to come for something like that? And I've been so far very good at producing the resources for the encounters that I want to produce along the way, but I am part of a naturalization that we also carve out of a laptop. It's not, I'm no institution in that sense. So when I have this kind of dream, it refers to like 5 or 10 people, which is not something that I can scale up, of course. So it's easier for me to speak like that.
Yeah, what I was trying to say is not to stop doing what we are doing, actually, but just surpass it or trying to add a dimension that meta thinks about the importance of thinking versus the importance of articulated knowledge in disciplines and in ways of transmitting space of power, ideas of repetition and continuation, tradition, situating knowledge versus those that do not possess it, constructing it versus the antagonism of those that are ignorant, we think, and then how necessary it is to explore it in a complete different way in order to produce, let's say, an entrance that has been or is being produced by many artists. We are talking about it many times, like from ethno-knowledges to indigenous and First Nation knowledges, and also the dispossessed, and many of those communities that we really want to be part of the construction of the social in the future instead of that kind of destillative model that is always in opposition of these things. But I know it's very, very even difficult to imagine. What I'm saying is that it's fundamental to do both, you know, to have like the two roles, the one that is defending as you are, very rightly so, the production of the conditions and just growing in the same direction that these things are in vogue or in fashion, and then you can just use that space to produce more and to possibilitate them, on the other hand, cheat on them. Cheat on them in a philosophical way. So, you know, like spend time thinking exactly what are we doing and what would be the future if we continued assuming those models without actually listening to something that is happening. I think I'm not inventing. For many centuries, philosophy and artists have been also trying to explore the other one. So that's not opaque or invisible. So. Should we open it to the audience so that you can scream at us a little bit? Somebody enraged or wanted to say something, also question?
Just a quick question. It seemed like there's a kind of dichotomy between a reformist position and a revolutionary, sort of Menshevik, Bolshevik, social democrat, communist. And it seems to be moving back and forth between, you know, philosophically, I think it's a lot easier maybe to be a revolutionary. And I'm just wondering about this dichotomy that you probably also experienced between, you know, saying something like, don't do research, do something else. This is sort of the revolutionary perspective, and then, or a kind of fundamental critique. But yeah, just maybe respond to that, and then context, maybe you don't seem that way, but it seems that there is this tension.
There is this tension, but the tension is really not based on revolution versus reform. It's about the possibility of, let's call it, a metamorphosis inside the models that we inherit and we respect, we work on, we actually acknowledge the positive parts that they have, and yet we do or we are responsible, if we want, to listen to an incredible tradition of those that from anthropology to philosophy have been trying to make attention that there is a different way of conceiving life that is not entirely based on the intelligence of the human, and that this poses incredible epistemological challenges to us, and also the idea that even after the disaster and after nature, there may be life, and that life is not defined by the fact that we exist. So, you know, in that morphing is something completely, let's call it, organic. I don't think that there is. When I say that it's morally wrong to do the research, I totally believe on that. But I still do it. And I still write my grants in the way that the grants are understood. And yet, I do think that in forums like this one, and in the text that many are writing tomorrow, you are listening to Elizabeth Bominelli, the last book of her, trying to criticize the liberal imagination of the horizon, is not very different from what I'm trying to say today here. So if you you know, if you read Cell, if you go into certain moments of Deleuze, you would find exactly that possibility, and even in Foucault. So it's, I think, very important to just be attentive, because this attention is not only in philosophers, this attention is in practice. If you look at many of the artistic productions and the way that artists are talking and addressing the subject, is that. So I'm not inventing, and I will never call it a revolution because it's not in opposition, but it's in addition, expansion, and metamorphic force that is inside us that we need to listen to, I think.
And just to add a little bit, yes, there is a tension, but I don't see that. I mean, I see that tension as a positive space to inhabit, because if we don't pay attention to that tension that you mentioned, then we become very complacent and we replicate colonial models. So I do not want to be an anthropologist for the world and all of a sudden be presenting findings of indigenous cultures of first knowledges, or how botanists in the pre-Columbian America dealt with certain things without becoming profoundly implicated myself. And because if I take research as the shield that I use to get really comfortable with my subject matter and not implicating myself, then I don't know if I'm doing things any different.
Any other polemical questions? Friday night. We should have fun up here, you know?
Or drinks.
Bueno, we pass then to the drinks. Since you are shy, we remain in the space so that you can approach us. And we thank you very much for being here tonight.
Their bag. I'm not sure whose it is. At the entrance.
Thank you. Thank you.